Nikola and Bosch are ready with hydrogen. In what many consider a controversial technology, Nikola is on track to launch its fuel cell electric tray in July after retooling and readjusting its manufacturing line in Coolidge, Arizona. Many will say it's too early for hydrogen trucks to be on the road when battery electric trucks themselves have not performed that well. But according to CEO Michael Loeskeller, this is the exact right approach that an early mover like Nikola needs to make, particularly with strong partners like Bosch. In this video, I want to explain exactly what Nikola and Bosch's partnership brings to the table, as well as explaining the advantages from a cost and sustainability perspective that hydrogen trucks will provide. Because obviously today there is a lot of debate between battery electric and fuel cell. But as usual folks, before we get into it, make sure to drop me a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. So to start things off, let's understand where Nikola stands with its fuel cell production plans, as well as how well their battery electric truck has sold over the past 12 months. You see, last year Nikola produced almost 300 battery electric trucks from its production line in Coolidge, Arizona. Those are typically done on a 1-2 shifts a day basis, which is pretty impressive for a company that did not have a factory this time 72 months ago. And in the first quarter, they produced another 63 units, but only 31 of those were sold to dealers. And this is where some of the concerns around Nikola's focus on hydrogen start to arise from. Because if you're not selling battery electric trucks that well, then why would you invest in a hydrogen ecosystem? And well, the answer to that question is very simple. Because there is very little competition right now with a large total addressable market. It's been proven numerous times that green hydrogen technologies are going to play an elemental role in the decarbonization race of states and countries. And the US is investing heavily with the Inflation Reduction Act through tax credits and production incentives for companies to produce hydrogen at scale. There's already numerous suppliers and logistics businesses like Lint and Air Liquide that supply hydrogen fuel in liquid tankers and compressed gas to any customer that wants to use it. In this case, Nikola is taking on the charge to control that molecule so that it comes to their own customers at a competitive price without the customer having to worry about finding a third-party refueling station. And because Nikola is an early-stage startup, they can do these investments without having to worry about a legacy business. And this is why Bosch partnered with Nikola to supply them the fuel cell modules so Nikola could start testing and validating the fuel cell truck earlier than any other company could. And it's safe to say that Bosch knows exactly what they're doing. They've been in this industry for more than 130 years and have been the primary supplier of various components in cars over the past 100. The company does more than $91 billion in annual revenue selling services and, in some cases, its R&D and technology. And in this case, Bosch is deciding to step it up with investments in hydrogen fuel cells, production, and storage. They just announced a $200 million facility in South Carolina to produce fuel cell stacks, and as a matter of fact, Nikola's Coolidge, Arizona facility itself will also get a fuel cell power module R&D sub. This means that somebody like Nikola Motors can focus purely on the system integration, validation, testing, marketing, and logistics for the product, something that an OEM supplier like Bosch simply can't do. And although currently Nikola already designs, manufactures, and procures its own battery modules and packs in-house, in the very near future, fuel cells could also become a part of that vertical integration. But that does not make sense right now from a business perspective because the goal is to get to market as fast as possible and obtain market share for electrification. And inherently, a fuel cell system has more components than a battery electric only system. You have control units, recirculation blowers, pressure regulators, valves, and different sensors that need to regulate the pressure of hydrogen to feed the fuel cell stack at the appropriate temperature and speed. That's going to determine the effective power output of the stack, which is going to feed the battery and the electric motor. But despite this complexity, the cost and weight of a fuel cell electric drivetrain is still less than of a competing battery electric one. On average, for any truck with a range more than 500 to 600 miles, the battery is going to weigh less than 10% that of a battery electric one. Not only that, but the fuel cell tanks and the stack themselves also weigh around 10 to 20% of the weight of the battery itself, which means you're going to have a minimum 20% gain in weight advantage compared to battery electric for a fuel cell. And that obviously does not even consider the supply chain and sustainability considerations for batteries compared to fuel cells. Although a fuel cell does use some other rare metals like platinum and iridium, it does not use nearly the same amount of raw materials and process materials as a lithium-ion battery. This is a pretty big deal because as batteries become a bigger and bigger component of electrification, they're going to start to take more materials on an exponential basis. For consumer electronics, it's been fine because these devices are extremely small. But as you scale up the energy capacity and power output of a battery, you're adding exponentially more weight and more materials. Unlike in a fuel cell system where you can simply scale the amount of tanks you have and leave the fuel cell stack at the same power rating in case you want to add more range. And unlike a lithium-ion battery, a fuel cell stack does not degrade with higher temperatures. Neither does it lose that much performance at lower temperatures. Similarly, a fuel cell stack does not have to worry about the short circuit that could occur from degradation resulting in thermal runaway that has plagued many EVs over the past few years. This means there's less toxic fumes that could be resulted from such a fire, and naturally you are using a safer technology that does not have to worry about getting short-circuited with any external connection. Because at the end of the day, a fuel cell is not storing any energy, it is producing energy from hydrogen gas, whereas a battery is simply a form of energy storage. On top of that, from an end-use point of view, a hydrogen vehicle will provide a very similar use case and application as a diesel or gasoline counterpart. Because obviously hydrogen is going to be transported in tankers and pipelines, and that is much easier to transport as a molecule compared to electricity on the grid. At the end of the day, the electric grid was designed to handle static loads from houses and buildings, and not necessarily dynamic loads from electric vehicles. This means that a hydrogen ecosystem will provide more reliability and increase the effectiveness of the electric grid, because it's not going to rely on it on a real-time basis. On top of that, the production of green hydrogen can be done far, far away where renewable energy is abundant and then transported easily to wherever it needs to be used. And this, at the end of the day, will result in less infrastructure needed for each incremental fuel cell truck that is added on the road. Whereas for a battery electric truck, you're going to need a new charging station and dispenser for each truck that is added, because obviously it takes much longer to refill and recharge a battery electric compared to a fuel cell. Because of these advantages, being an early mover in this space makes a lot of sense. And even though in the short term it's going to require a lot of capital and potential risk from investors, it is well worth it to help bring a sustainable solution to the market. Costs will only come down with scale, and at the end of the day, EVs were also very expensive 20 years ago. As usual, guys, let me know your thoughts down in the comment section below. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll catch you guys in the next one. Take care.